differential equations have a lot of use in modeling physical problems, particularly engineering problems. This first example I want to talk about is not an engineering problem. I guess you would call it a financial mathematics problem, but it actually occurs in many other sort of physical problems, not just this problem of compound interest. So it's useful for engineers, but even compound interest itself is useful for everybody. So what is compound interest? If you view that you have some deposit, say in a bank account or in an investment fund, let's just talk about a bank account for simplicity. The bank can give you interest on your deposit. When you earn interest on the interest, we call that compounding, and that would be compound interest. You can get a differential equation from compound interest in the limit that the compounding occurs continuously, and I'll show you how that works out. It's an interesting example to do because we can then show, I can also show you how to derive a differential equation. So let's assume that we have some amount of money in a bank account, S of t at time t, S at time t, we'll call that S of t. We want to calculate how much money we have at some arbitrary time. And we start at time t, we start with the amount of money S of t. And we ask, how much money do we have in the bank account at a time t plus delta t? Okay? So initially you can view, say, t is now, and how much money do we have 1 month from now? So delta t can be 1 month, or if t is in units of years, delta t would be 1/12 of a year. So how much money do we have in the account at time t plus delta t? Well, it's the amount of money we have in the account at time t plus the interest we've earned in the account. So the interest we earned on the account depends on the interest rate, r, so plus r, but we've only earned interest over a time delta t. So say r could be something like 6% per year for an investment. So r would be, say, 0.06 per year. And if delta t was 1 month, then delta t would be 1/12 of a year. So you don't earn 6% over 1 month. You earn r times delta t over the shorter period of time. And you're earning this as a percentage of the amount of money you have in the account, so times S of t. So that's the interest you've earned over the time period delta t. And to this, we'll add one more term. Maybe you're depositing money into the account. Say you're working, and every month you're putting a fraction of your paycheck into the account. So let's say you're putting K dollars per year into the account. So to this, we have K dollars per year, but delta T is not a year. You're only putting money in over the period delta T. Delta T is 1 month. It would be 1/12 of a year. So you add amount of money K delta T. That's your deposits. So the amount of money you have in the account at time T plus delta T is the amount of money you have in the account at time t plus the interest you earned on that amount of money over the time delta t plus the amount of money you added to the account over the time delta t. We can take this equation and we can try to get a derivative out of it. We can write S of t plus delta t minus S of t, and then divide through by delta t. And if we do that, then on the right-hand side, we have left an r times an s plus a k. So r s of t plus k. Okay. To get the differential equation, we need continuous compounding. So rather than compounding getting interest once a month, we view once a day, or once an hour, or once a minute, once a second. We can take the limit as this delta t goes to 0, and then we get a derivative. So we get the differential equation ds dt equals rs plus k. To solve a first-order differential equation, we need to know how much money we had in the account initially at t equals 0. So s of 0 we specify as s naught. Okay, compound interest equation. This we recognize as a linear first-order equation. So we can put it in standard form. Let me do that here. So we have ds dt minus rs equals k. And that's the standard form for a linear first-order equation. We can solve that using the method we know. We need an integrating factor. So the integrating factor is e to the integral of p of t dt. P of t is minus r here. So e to the integral from 0 to t of p of t dt, so minus r dt. So that's just e to the minus r t. So that's our integrating factor. And then we can write down the solution for s. So we have s of t is equal to 1 divided by the integrating factor, which is e to the rt, times the initial value, s naught, plus the integral from 0 to t of mu of t, the integrating factor, times the right-hand side, g of t, which is k, dt. So e to the minus rt k dt. Okay, that's our expression for the amount of money at time t. So we have to do this integral. This is a rather simple integral to do. We're integrating, k is a constant, so we're integrating e to the minus rt dt. That becomes minus 1 over r e to the minus rt. And then we can evaluate it at the upper limit minus the lower limit. If we do that, and we multiply through by e to the rt, we'll obtain the expression s naught e to the rt plus k over r e to the rt times 1 minus e to the minus rt. And that's the solution to our compound interest problem. Okay? Let's try and interpret this solution. So S naught is the initial money in the account, and we see that compounding causes the initial money to grow exponentially. That's always a good thing when your money grows exponentially, right? So this is the initial growth. This is the growth of your initial deposit. And then you've put in K dollars per year, say, into this account, and that money you put in will also grow exponentially. If this is, say, a retirement account and we're looking something like 40 years into the future, 30 years into the future, this e to the minus rt might be small relative to 1, and then you get this amount, this deposits growing exponentially. If you look at this expression, it may worry you a little bit, because if r goes to 0, meaning that the bank is not giving you any interest, then you have a division by 0 here. But if you look at 1 minus e to the minus rt, that would be 1 minus 1 as r goes to 0. So this expression is actually 0 divided by 0. So I think it's worthwhile to make sure we get the right answer here. So if we wanted to look at, say, the limit as the interest rate goes to 0, right, of s of t, what would we get? The first term would be s naught. What would this term get. You can use, say, L'Hopital's rule. If you use L'Hopital's rule, you would take the derivative with respect to R, right? Derivative with respect to R of this expression. Actually, all we need then is the limit of 1 minus e to the minus rt divided by r. We can carry the k e to the rt term, so because this is the 0 divided by 0. If we use L'Hopital's rule and take the derivative with respect to r, this one would become t times e to the rt divided by 1. So if you can do that, then and put r goes to 0, what you'll see is you get s naught plus k times t. And that's what you would expect, because if the bank is not giving you any interest, the amount of money you have in your account is your initial deposit plus how much money you've put into the account at time t. So if you're putting, say, $20,000 per year into the account, after 10 years, you would have put $200,000 into the account. So this is the expression for any interest rate. And I just check to make sure you get the right answer if the interest rate goes to 0. Okay, a very useful expression. You can use it to evaluate retirement savings. I ask you to do that as an exercise after this video. So let me review what we've done here. We've looked at the application of compound interest. I wanted to show you how to derive a differential equation. To derive a differential equation for the amount of money you have in the account, you consider how much money you have in the account at t plus delta t, a time delta t from the time t. That's in terms of the amount of money you have in the account at time t, plus what happens over the time delta t. Over the time delta t, the bank gives you interest and you make a deposit. Then you can form this difference equation, which is a derivative. Use the definition of a derivative. Take the limit that delta t goes to 0, a very common sort of technique to derive a differential equation. And we end up with here, in this case, we end up with a first order linear differential equation, which we can solve by our known method. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.